My youngest patient with a neuroendocrine tumor was 6 years old. The good thing is that was probably 20 years ago when that child was six, and we worked with her and we put her in a new clinical trial. She had surgery both before and after the therapy. And believe it or not, this young woman is now in her 20s and she's disease-free. Any child in the hospital is allowed to come up to this press room, this very room we're in, and the windows look out right out on the stadium. At the end of the first quarter of every football game, everyone in the stands, and all the players, all the referees, all the coaches, stand and wave to the children up here in the hospital. And that's why it's called the wave. I mean, you just have to look at the face on those kids. It's a time for kids to have a happy moment. Children and adults who have neuroendocrine tumors often have symptoms for a long time before they're actually diagnosed, meaning that many of our patients already have metastatic disease by the time we see them. I see children who have had disease in their liver, in their bones even, by the time they got to me. And they had had symptoms for 3 or 4 or 5 years. Bellyache, which, you know, we all say, get over a bellyache. I often say as a pediatric oncologist, it's the family physician on the front line who has that light bulb go on and say, hey, this isn't just a bellyache. Once that light bulb goes on for the pediatrician, then by the time they get to me, I know what to do to say, well, is it there or is it not? It is deciding whether the MRI that they've already had at home or the CT that they already had at home is very sensitive, but now I go in and give them the PET scan and we look at those two together. And you know, one of the benefits of so much data, but not only data, but ways to put two kinds of data together. So if a family sends me a CT, and we do the PET scan, then we can digitally, electronically go in and match those so that we can exactly see whether the little ditzel on the CT scan matches what's on the PET scan. Those are the kinds of things that make us better able to diagnose them. And I think the better diagnosis and the earlier, you know, we're trying to move farther and farther back in the stage of the disease to be able to make the diagnosis earlier. And that's gonna really help us be able to make progress in this disease. In children, the most common places are the small intestine, the pancreas, the lung, the breasts, and the ovaries. One thing that is different in neuroendocrine tumors from other solid tumors in children is the idea that once you have metastasis, you can still go in and take out and do surgery. Now, oftentimes in adults, when a patient shows up and they have metastatic disease, particularly to the bones or the liver, then no further surgery would be done. We don't feel that way at all in terms of children with neuroendocrine tumors. Patients do better even if they have metastatic disease if you go in and remove some of the tumor. The most important thing is to be able to find the primary tumor, because that's most likely the source of all the metastatic disease. If you don't get that out, then, you know, whatever treatment you give, you still have that primary there feeding. So I think that's one of the biggest differences, is our emphasis on doing surgery and removing surgically as much disease as you can.
So she was 7 years old when it first started. She would have stomach aches. You just know, like when they say, well, we think it's IBS, or we think it's Crohn's disease, or possible bacterial infection in her intestines. You just know as a parent, I think you have that intuition that you know it's something more.
I remember like going to Children's Hospital first, and they didn't really know much about it.
The doctor came in and asked if he could talk to me. He asked for me to go into another room with him, and we went in there, and I sat down, and he kind of pushed a box of Kleenexes towards me, and I sat down, and I shoved the Kleenexes back at him because, I don't know, it just scared me. He said it was a malignant carcinoid tumor. I don't even know if there's a right way to have to tell a little kid that, you know. I didn't tell Emily for, I think it was 2 more days. I couldn't bring myself. I don't know if I should have kept it from her for that long or if I should have told her right away, or I don't know if I have the right words for anyone to have to tell their kid that they have cancer. It was really hard to tell her. She knew something was going on. She just sat up and she asked me flat out, she said, "Mom, do I have cancer?" And that's when I had to tell her. And she did.
How do you tell a parent that their child has cancer? How do you approach that?
Well, I say, your child has cancer and we're very good at treating it. And by that, I don't mean me. I mean, you know, the whole community of pediatric oncologists. The advice I would give the parent is either who has a child with a neuroendocrine tumor is to seek out the closest center that has a real neuroendocrine tumor clinic. I like to work with the family physician or the pediatric oncologist closest to their home, and then we would manage that child together. And many times the child would need to come here if they were going to get the treatment, and especially if they were going to get peptide receptor radiotherapy. But most of their work could be done at home, and I think it's really important if we can keep the children closer to home to be able to do that. I feel I have an obligation to tell the child as well, but I always ask the parents, do you want me to tell your child? Should we tell them as a family and you give them the news, or we sit down together and I give them the news? But I think it's very important to tell the child. They know something's going on. And, you know, I think it's the more they know, the better they can help psychologically fight it.